matter in case of dogs. Or the mastitis can also be seen. And other than these, there were in case of poultry, we have seen air sacculitis, septicemia, pneumonia, all this due to the organism which are affecting other than the intestine. So the E. coli organism, they are affecting the intestine. Other than the intestine, they can affect the other organs. They can affect the respiratory system. They can affect the blood, or they can affect the lungs, responsible for causing pneumonia. So they may also be causing hepatitis, or particularly in the when they are affecting the urinary tract, they may be causing the biometral. And when they are affecting the mammary gland, they are responsible for causing mastitis, or they are also affecting the navel cord, responsible for causing omphalitis. So today we will be seeing the E. coli organisms, which are particularly affecting the intestine. So these organisms are particularly classified according to their, we can say, which type of infection they are causing. So first type of, now today we are talking about the E. coli organism, which are affecting the intestine. So first organism, or these are not the, they are, we can say, they are the variant strains of the E. coli. So first is known as a ETEC. ETEC is E for enterotoxigenic E. coli. Okay, enterotoxigenic E. coli. So this enterotoxigenic E. coli, it means from the name itself, they are producing, responsible for causing enterotoxin. Entero means related with the intestine. So they are responsible for causing enterotoxins. And they are particularly affecting different host species, and they are having the fimbriel adhesions. Fimbriel adhesions means fimbri, yesterday we have seen fimbri is there, and generally K88 or K89 fimbri is there, which is responsible for causing adhesions. Some porcine ETEC have EIDA adhesions also, and these enterotoxins, they are of two types. Okay, they are the heat levitoxins and heat ETEC. They are of two types. They are known as heat levitoxin and heat stable toxin. And levile and stable are wig associated, means they can be seen in case of pigs. And STA is found in calves and pigs, and STB is found is pig associated. So heat labile and heat stable toxins, they are associated in case of pigs, but when STA, that is the heat stable A toxin, it can be seen in the calves also and pigs also, whereas STB is pig associated. And these are the enterotoxins, which are heat stable or the heat labile, they are associated with the, responsible for causing secretory diarrhea. So these heat stable toxin or labile toxin, they are responsible for causing the secretory diarrhea to increase chloride and hypocarbonate secretion and inhibition of sodium absorption. Although the mechanism of action of other toxins may be differing, but here they are due to the increased chloride secretion. So diarrhea, so what will be the outcome in case of ETEC? Diarrhea in neonatal piglets, calves and lambs. So post-weaning diarrhea in pigs, pups, usually due to the STA strains. So these, so whenever there is a neonatal diarrhea in case of pigs and calves and lambs also, there are chances that it may be due to the ETEC, enterotoxigenic E. coli. This is the specific E. coli, which will be affecting the intestine, and they may be the heat level or the heat labile toxin. So first is the ETEC. Now second toxins or the strains of the E. coli, which is affecting the intestines, are known as EEEC, that is attaching and efficacing E. coli. Attaching and efficacing, AEEC. This attaching and efficacing E. coli is further divided into two broader groups. They are the enteropathogenic E. coli, EPEC, and Shiga toxin producing E. coli. Now, enteropathogenic E. coli, again, this this enteropathogenic E. coli, they are further being divided into two groups. They are the typical enteropathogenic E. coli and atypical enteropathogenic E. coli and typical enteropathogenic E. coli. Attaching and efficacing E. coli. Attaching means these E. coli, they are responsible for attaching into the intestine and they are also destroying the cells there. So these attaching and efficacing E. coli, they are of two types. Okay, they are atypical EPC and typical EEC. So in atypical EPC, the enterotoxins are not being identified, and in both the case, enterotoxins have not been identified. But in case of atypical EPC, intamin is a bacterial outer membrane protein. It binds to the TIR, a translocated bacterial protein in the host cell. So binding is with the help of the intamin. While in case of typical major adhesins is EAF and intamin, both are there. So enterotoxins are not identified. Attaching and efficacing lesions are determined by the locus of enterocyte effacement. So result in intimate adherence to the enterocytes and effacement of microvilli. These are microvilli, they are being destroyed because these atypical EPC, they are adhering with the enterocytes present in the microvilli. So once adhered, so these microvilli, they will be particularly destroyed. So clinical signs range from slight change to hemorrhagic diarrhea in calves. Okay, so what will be the outcome in case of atypical EPC? Clinical signs from slight change to hemorrhagic diarrhea in calves, because there is sloughing of the microvilli, so there will be the hemorrhages. So hemorrhagic diarrhea in calves, pigs and dogs, lambs and kids occasionally affected. So majorly it is seen in case of calves, pigs and dogs. So major cause of diarrhea in neonatal and weaning rabbits. So now, when it is the typical EPC, uncommon pathogen in the intestinal tract of the animal, implicated in human infantile diarrhea in developing countries. So this is particularly seen in the typical EPC, affecting and efficacing E. coli is seen in case of human beings. And the infantile diarrhea in most of the developing countries is uncommon pathogen. So, but it is responsible for causing infantile diarrhea. So the main mechanism of the action will be the same, but this is the atypical and this will be the typical EPEC. And the second AEC, the attaching and efficacy, is the Shiga toxin producing E. coli. Now this Shiga toxin producing E. coli is further divided into two. First is the enterohemorrhagic E. coli, EHEC. So here again the major adhesin is the intamin. Intamin, with the help of the intamin, these E. coli used to adhere with the intestine or the micro or the enterocytes present in the villi. So STH toxin exert their toxic effect on the endothelial cells. And this is again the rare cause of hemorrhagic diarrhea in calves. Cattle are the important asymptomatic carrier of the EHEC, and other domestic animal may be the reservoir of EHEC. So particularly it is seen in case of cattle or the newborn cattle, we can say, in case of calves. And particularly in case of pigs, in case of pigs, due to STC or the Shiga toxin producing E. coli, there is edema disease in recently weaned pigs. And this is due to the strain of E. coli producing edema disease. And the major particular adhesin is the Fimbriel 18 Fimbri. And the major toxin is the STX2E. And alpha-hemolysin is also present. So STX2E toxin damage vascular endothelial target tissue, resulting in localized edema. So I am also not going into much more details of the types of the strains, but you must know which are the different type of the intestinal E. coli or the extra intestinal E. coli. And other than the last form of the strains, intestinal strains, is the enteroaggregative E. coli. Enteroaggregative means E. coli will be aggregated at the microvilli. So what will be there? Again, there are two types, atypical type and the typical. So adhesions not being identified. Here, previously in attaching and efficacy E. coli, we have seen that adhesions were there, but in enteroaggregation, where the aggregation is there, there no intimate or adhesions has been found. So, and enterotoxins has also not been identified. So, what we will be seeing here, we will be seeing that stacked brick formation of epithelial cells. So, we are saying that there enteroaggregative means aggregations are there of the E. coli. So, that's why we are saying is the enteroaggregative E. coli. So, just a brick ke baad ek baryo mein lage rehte, just like the E. coli, they will be adhering with each other and they will be affecting the intestine, but there won't be any intimin or the any adhesions for the attachment. So frequently subclinical, occasionally associated diarrhea in animals. While the typical agro-irritative E. coli, aggressive adherence fimbri, okay, and two major toxins has been identified. They are the yeast one, that is the plasmid encoded toxin spike. And the histopathology characterized by stacked brick formation of epithelial cells. So, in both the cases, you will be forming the stacked brick. That's why we have kept in enteroaggregative. Jaise brick ek dusre se arrange rehte hain, to dono typical ho ya atypical ho, enteroaggregative aggression hai, matlab dono mein hi ek dusre se aise jude hue brick ke form mein E. coli attach rahenge. And but in the typical one, there we will be finding the toxins, while in case of atypical one, you won't be finding any of the toxins. So, diarrhea in case of humans have been notified with the typical agro-aggregative E. coli. So, now you can know that the E. coli, they are a major responsible organism for causing diarrhea in case of neonatal or any of the large animals. So, what are the disease conditions other than these which we have seen by the E. coli? So, particularly in case of calves less than 1 week old. Matlab ki jo 1 week se kam ke calf hai, उनमें हमको मिलता व्हाइट स्कोर और कोलीबैसोलोसिस. जैसे गांव में बोलते हैं गाय का दूध पी रहा है या भैंस का दूध पी रहा लगातार बच्चा, इसके लिए उसको जो डायरिया होता है वो व्हाइट कलर का होता है, ठीक है, कंटिन्यूस मिल्क पीने से. एंड बट इट मे बी ड्यू टू द व्हाइट स्कोर ऑफ कोलीबैसोलोसिस. It is due to the colibacillosis. So the appetite is normal at the first but decreases as the feces become more fluid. So here you will be finding the white fluid or the pasty feces. Again, in case of calf less than 1 week old, colliseptisemia can be seen. It may be due to the enteric shock, colliseptisemia, and here may be the sign of the diarrhea. Other than these, the conditions will be the calf surviving septicemia or the bacteremia. They will be suffering from the joint ill. The disease condition is known as joint ill. What is joint ill? E. coli are localized in the joints and of kidney, and entry can be via the umbilicus. So there will be the swelling in the joint, and the positive organisms may be the particularly E. coli. And the coliform mastitis can also be seen. While in case of poultry, the disease condition is known as Hazare disease. Hazare disease. In case of poultry or larger poultry or the layers, we can say the disease is known as Hazare disease. H-A-Z-Z-A-R-E, Hazare disease. While in case of young one, you can see diarrhea can be there, or there will be the omphalitis can also be noticed. Now coming for the important thing, is the laboratory diagnosis. आपने देख लिया clinically the animals are affected with different disease. Okay, now you have to prove that the organism which is present or the why this disease is there. Because until and unless you are doing the laboratory diagnosis or the proper diagnosis, you can't be a very good clinicians. So what our ultimate aim is? Our ultimate aim is to prevent the disease and to treat the disease. So how, if there are so many disease conditions are there, diarrhea, agar hum diarrhea ki baat kare, in so many disease conditions there will be the diarrhea. So how you will able to treat? Okay, so for the treatment, efficient treatment, you must know that you have to do the proper diagnosis. So for the diagnosis, first of all, look at the points. Four things are very important whenever you are going for the diagnosis. First thing is, before diagnosing, you must go for laboratory diagnosis. you must go for the clinical symptoms and history of the animal. Take the history of the animal and see the clinical symptoms of the animal for any of the disease. So whenever you have seen the animal or whenever you are going for the treatment, you have to go near to the animal. Clinically, you have to observe the animal, but the clinical signs are particularly, we are not able to differentiate, because when we are taking off seeing the diarrhea is there in animal, it can be the bacterial origin. So many bacteria are there for the diarrhea, or there may be viral origin or the fungal origin. So once you have seen that the animal is suffering from the diarrhea, what you have to do? You have to take the history from the owner, but don't rely on the history of the owner. Once you have taken the history, now you will be collecting the samples. So samples collection will be depending on the clinical signs. The clinical signs which you will be seeing in the animals, accordingly you will be collecting the samples. So if you are finding the diarrhea is there, what will be the best sample? The samples which you will be collecting in case of the diarrhea, if the feces is voided, just freshly voided feces can be collected, or you can also collect the cloacal swab or the fecal swab or the rectal swab. Rectal swab in case of large animal, cloacal swabs in case of poultry. So you can directly collect the swabs. या तो हम स्वैब ले सकते हैं या फिर फ्रेशली वॉइडेड फीसिस को हम कलेक्ट कर सकते हैं. सो इफ इट इज अ केस ऑफ डायरिया, बट इफ इट इज अ केस ऑफ मैस्टाइटिस, सो वी हैव टू कलेक्ट द मिल्क सैंपल. इफ इट इज अ केस ऑफ पायोमेट्रा, देन वी हैव टू कलेक्ट द पस सैंपल फ्रॉम द यूट्रस. और इफ इट इज अ केस ऑफ urinary tract infection, you have to collect the urine. If it is a respiratory tract infection, then we have to collect the swabs. So the samples will be collected according to the lesions which you will be or the clinical symptoms. Now once you have collected the sample, you have brought the sample into the laboratory. Now instead of a particular, I can say a clinician, you are a laboratory person. So what you will be doing as a laboratory person, what you will be doing? Now you are inside the laboratory. So you have, once you have collected the sample and dispatched the sample in a proper way to the laboratory, now you are inside the laboratory. So what you will be doing? Once the sample you have received, you have to check the sample that they are okay. Then they have been properly labeled or not, and it is in the, they are putrefied or it is in the okay condition. Now you will be going for direct examination. What do you mean by the direct examination? Direct examination means, direct examination matlab jo sample aaya humne sample mein direct dekh liya, that is the direct examination. So 4 points will be there. First will be the direct examination we can perform in the laboratory. Second is the isolation and the identification of the organism. Third is the immunological testing, and fourth is the molecular testing, and if pathogenicity testing is available, then we can perform that. Now coming for the direct examination. So when it is a direct examination means, I am saying you have collected the sample and you will be directly making the smears and seeing it under the observation or observing it under the microscope. So in case of typical, I can say E. coli or the Escherichia coli infection, what you will be doing? You will be collecting the feces. You or the, according to the clinical sample, now you will be making a smear. Okay. Once you have made a smear, you will be able to see the organism inside the microscope. Once you have seen the organism inside the microscope, now you can also go for observing the under motility test. Direct examination, you can perform the motility test. So how we are able to say that the gram negative when you are performing the gram staining? This is the gram staining of the direct examination of a particularly blood picture. Blood was collected and the direct examination was made. So here you can see that the small structure, they are the gram negative and they have been stained with the gram staining. You can see that the gram negative organisms are being observed. So they are the gram negative. So in direct examination, when we are performing the gram staining, when you are performing the gram staining, you can see that Particularly, there will be the gram-negative organism, rod-shaped, motile, non-spore-forming organism. So, other than this, which other direct examination you can perform? You can also perform the immunological method or nucleic acid method directly from the samples. Okay, directly from the fecal sample, you can perform the molecular test. You can perform the immunological test. But in case of E. coli, it is not required. So I have told that not applicable. Here it is not applicable. So once you have in the direct examination, you will be staining with the gram staining. Then you will be able to say that the organism is gram negative, rod shape, motile, non-spore forming organism. Motile organism, you will be able to say with the help of the motility in, particularly you will be seeing motility where it is not in the gram staining. Motility, we have to observe the motility of the organism by the hanging drop method. So now Ajay is also sending you the practical of bacteriology. Go through it one by one so you will be able to understand what I am speaking. But once you have collected the direct sample, हमने direct sample feces का लिया, पर अब हम इसमें से नहीं बता पाएंगे कि ये E. coli ही था. So what we can do? Only suspected we can say जो हमने blood smear में देखा, they were the gram positive, gram negative rods. Okay, gram negative rods in the gram staining. So हमने बोला they will be suspected from the gram negative organism. So for the confirmation, what we have to do? We have to go for isolation and identification of the organism. For isolation, and अब हमको bacteria को lab में isolate करना है, मतलब grow करना है, उसको single form में लाना, pure करना है और उसको identification करना है. तो जो basal media क्या है? Basal media मतलब जिससे basic requirement पूरी हो रही है, वहाँ ज़्यादा growth नहीं हो रही है, पर growth हो जाएगी, but they are not the flourish growth. So अगर हमने बेसल मीडिया लिया आइसोलेशन के लिए न्यूट्रिएंट ब्रोथ, ब्रोथ मींस दिस इज द लिक्विड मीडिया. अगर हमने न्यूट्रिएंट ब्रोथ लिया बेसल मीडिया में एंड वी हैव इनोकुलेटेड द सैंपल, हमने फीसिस लाया उसका एक इनोकुलम हमने लेके, एक इनोकुलेशन लूप, अब आप लोगों ने इनोकुलेशन लूप भी नहीं देखा है, वन इनोकुलम वी हैव टू टेक, मीन्स दिस इज इनोकुलेशन लूप, पर्टिकुलरली इट इज हैविंग 0.2 mm और 0.2 or 0.1 mm, and it can be very small quantity of the fecal sample or any of the sample can be taken. Now you will be inoculating it into the nutrient broth. Nutrient broth ka tube rehta, test tube mein humne 5 ml nutrient broth liya hai. Usme humne usse fecal sample ko inoculate kar diya. Ab inoculate kar diya, then we have to incubate it in incubator at 37 degree centigrade for 18 hours. So next day hum kya denge, humko kya dikhega, there will be the turbidity in the media and sediment at the bottom. So ye kya ho gaya, basal media hoga for isolation and the identification. This is for isolation and the identification, this is the basal media. Ab basal media के बाद हमको क्या करना है, न्यूट्रिएंट ब्रोथ हमने बेसल मीडिया लिया जिसमें बेसिक रिक्वायरमेंट पूरी हो रही. नाउ वी कैन आल्सो ग्रो दिस इनटू द न्यूट्रिएंट अगार. अगार मतलब कि हमने मीडिया को लिक्विड से सॉलिड कर दिया है. व्हेनेवर वी वांट द प्योर फॉर्म ऑफ द कॉलोनीज, वी हैव टू टेक द अगार. सो इन केस ऑफ न्यूट्रिएंट अगार, यू विल बी गेटिंग 2 to 3 mm whitish or yellowish colony or yellowish white colony in case of nutrient agar, that will be of the E. coli. Other than this, you can go for the enriched media. So the enriched media मतलब कि अब basic requirement हमारी पूरी हो गई, उसको हमने enriched कर दिया. So enriched media here is the blood agar. So what type of colonies? This is the growth, typical growth of E. coli in the blood agar. So the E. coli are hemolytic or the non-hemolytic strains. So and they used to produce the large gray moist colony. Here you can see the large gray and moist colony. Here, large gray and moist colony. So they may be the hemolytic or the non-hemolytic. So the colonies are grayish, round and shiny with a characteristic smell. So here these colonies, they are the non-hemolytic one. Here you are not seeing any hemolysis. Isme humko hemolysis kahan dikh raha hai? When you will be seeing here. Here it is the hemolysis. Here it is hemolysis. But some of the colonies, they are non-hemolytic one. And some of them are hemolytic one. Here you have seen the change in the color of the blood agar plate. Here it was red. So whenever there will be the hemolysis, there will be the change in the color, or the blood cells will be utilized by the E. coli. So there will be the hemolysis is noticed. Now coming for the selective and differential media. In isolation and identification, we have gone for the first is the basal media. Second is the in basal media, we have seen nutrient broth, nutrient agar, then the enriched media is the blood agar. Now coming for the selective and differential media. Okay. So on McConkie lactose agar. McConkie lactose agar, particularly when we are talking about the McConkie lactose agar. This is the growth of E. coli in McConkie lactose agar. It produces pink colony 2 to 3 mm in diameter and fermentation of lactose. Lactose fermentation is there. Here the pH indicator is neutral red. So neutral red particularly is pale straw at pH 8 and pink at pH or the acidic pH, it is pink. And it is pale or straw color or yellowish color at the basic pH. This is the nature of the indicator. This is neutral red. And the inhibitor which are being used in this case are the boiled salt and crystal violet. So when we have added the boiled salt and the crystal violet, so gram negative bacteria won't be growing. Enterobacteria, see, which used to require the boiled salt, they will be growing. And the crystal violet is here to inhibit the gram-positive bacteria. So, in a McConkie lactose agar, if you are taking, these are the lactose is there as a sugar. Now, bile salt and crystal violets are being there. And the indicator which is used is the neutral pH or the neutral red. And the indicator here is the neutral red. Now, just like if we are talking about the McConkie agar, is McConkie agar is also very good media for the growth of the, later on, I will be showing you the growth of the particularly E. coli on the McConkie agar. Again, the indicator in case of McConkie agar is the neutral red, and in case of McConkie agar, the sugar which is added is lactose. Okay? And the particularly inhibitors here is the bile salt and the crystal violet. So, what will be there? So, what is there? McConkie lactose agar, what will be there? Or it is also known as the McConkie agar. McConkie lactose agar or the McConkie agar. So, once the organism, if it is an E. coli, what it will be using? It will be using the lactose. अगर McConkie agar ये है McConkie lactose agar और E. coli organism है, it will be using the lactose. कल मैंने बताया था. And it will be forming the lactic acid. अगर lactic acid form हो रहा है तो क्या होगा? Acidic होगा pH. Acidic pH होगा तो यहाँ देखो neutral red का अगर acidic pH है तो colony कैसी आएंगी? Pink. So in case of McConkie lactose agar or the McConkie agar, the colonies are pink in color. Okay, the colonies are pink in color or reddish in color, but if it is a non-lactose fermenter, ठीक है? अगर कहीं इसकी जगह salmonella organism होता तो क्या होता? वो तो lactose को नहीं use कर पाता, it uses the sugar sucrose, but sucrose is not in the media. So क्या होगा? It will be using what it will be using in the media, particularly peptone is also being added. In this media, peptone is also being added. So, the organisms which are unable to utilize the lactose, they will be using the peptone. Once they will be using the peptone, peptone. So the nitrogen, which is being nitrogen as a source, so the media will be resulting into the alkaline product instead of acidic product. There will be the production of alkaline product. So the color of the media will be becoming yellowish. Okay. Other than this, we can also go for the E. coli, eosin, methylene blue agar. And in case of eosin, methylene blue agar, particularly if it is an E. coli organism, it used to give the metallic sheen, or the metallic sheen is produced. Green metallic sheen is being produced. ठीक है, तो जैसा metal चमकता है green color का, वैसा ही हमको eosin, methylene blue में अगर typical E. coli होगा, you will be getting the just like this growth. So the selective and the differential agar is McConkie lactose agar or McConkie agar and eosin in methylene blue agar. So, XLD media, it is left. Brilliant green agar, it is on the top. And the McConkie. Here we are concerned with the McConkie agar. So, in case of McConkie agar, in case of E. coli, अगर E. coli है तो McConkie agar में हमको कैसी ग्रोथ दिखेगी? पिंकिश कलर ग्रोथ दिखेगी. अभी ये दो मीडिया मैं आपसे अभी डिस्कस करूंगी, बट इन केस ऑफ साल्मोनेला. नाउ सी द सेम थ्री मीडिया, दैट इज द XLD, इज द XLD. दिस इज द पर्टिकुलरली ब्रिलियंट ग्रीन अगार एंड दिस इज द McConkie agar. And if it is in Klebsiella pneumoniae, now Klebsiella organism, they are again the lactose fermenter. But they are little bit slow in comparison to the E. coli. Here you can see the size of the colony. They are pinkish in nature, not that much pink as that were the E. coli. And the size of the colony are also large and they are mucoid in nature. Because this Klebsiella pneumoniae organism, they are capsulated. तो जो capsulated organism होंगे उनकी colonies कैसी रहेंगी? थोड़ी बड़ी और mucoid colony रहेंगी. So this Klebsiella organism, particularly pneumoniae organism, they will be having the large colonies, large pink colonies. And here you have seen that in the case of E. coli, they were having the pink small colonies. So these Klebsiella organism, they are, so this is the E. coli lactose fermenter. Here you can see the pink small colonies. Here you can see the Klebsiella organism. They are producing the large mucoid colony. So now coming for the one you have identified. ठीक है, आपने कॉलोनी देख ली है. अब कॉलोनी को अब आपको बायोकेमिकल टेस्ट परफॉर्म करना डिफरेंट. वंस यू आर परफॉर्मिंग द बायोकेमिकल टेस्ट, यस्टरडे आई हैव टोल्ड वी हैव टू परफॉर्म द इम्विक टेस्ट. इम्विक इज द इंडोल मिथाइल रेड वोगस प्रोस्कर एंड साइट्रेट. इम्विक इज द इंडोल मिथाइल रेड वोगस प्रोस्कर एंड द साइट्रेट, फोर टेस्ट. सो नाउ व्हेन टॉकिंग अबाउट द इस्टिचिया कोलाई, E. coli के केस में क्या होगा? इम्विक में पॉजिटिव पॉजिटिव, नेगेटिव नेगेटिव, मींस इंडोल इज पॉजिटिव, मिथाइल रेड इज पॉजिटिव, वोगस प्रोस्कर इज नेगेटिव एंड साइट्रेट यूटिलाइजेशन इज नेगेटिव इन केस ऑफ E. coli. सो इम्विक टेस्ट, यस आई वाज सेइंग दैट द इम्विक टेस्ट, दैट इज द इंडोल पॉजिटिव, मिथाइल रेड पॉजिटिव, वोगस प्रोस्कर एंड साइट्रेट यूटिलाइजेशन, दे आर द नेगेटिव. एंड द H2S प्रोडक्शन इज ऑल्सो नेगेटिव. Urease activity is also negative and lysine decarboxylation is positive. But in case of Enterobacteriaceae, IMVIC means these four tests, they are very important, and the differentiation of these organisms are basis of the IMVIC test. So all the organisms in the Enterobacteriaceae, all the organisms belonging to the Enterobacteriaceae, they are motile. Except the Klebsiella pneumoniae, because it is having the capsule. अगर capsule ही लगाए चारों तरफ से तो कहाँ से motile होगा? ठीक है, that's why it is non-motile. So here you can differentiate it. So as starting the E. coli first, you can see the E. coli. क्लिनिकल इम्पोर्टेंस मेजर पैथोजन पेशेंट्स में भी हीमोलिटिक और द नॉन हीमोलिटिक मोर्टेलिटी दे आर मोटाइल एंड लैक्टोज फर्मेंटेशन. नाउ इन केस ऑफ क्लेब्सिल्ला अप टू द ग्रोथ ऑफ द ऑर्गेनिज्म इन द मैकोन्की अगार यू हैव टू परफॉर्म द सेम थिंग. But when you have performed the biochemical test, here when you have performed the motility first, it will be the non-motile. And the, from the colonies itself, you will be getting some hint that the organism may be the Klebsiella. Again, it will be the lactose fermenter, but the invic pattern is reversed to the E. coli. It means it is indole negative, methyl red negative, but it is vagus proscor and citrate positive. Klebsiella. So here on the basis of the biochemical test, you will able to differentiate it. Here again, in case of Proteus species, later on I will be covering the Proteus. Okay. So these first you must know this much only. These are the biochemical tests. First one, in case of E. coli, and you must know about the Invic test. Invic test, indole, here you will be, these are the positive reaction. Indole, methyl red, vagus proscor and citrate. Okay, here, just you can see Invic in case of E. coli, positive, positive, negative, negative. Okay, so it is positive. E. coli, indole is positive, methyl red is positive. So in case of indole test, if it is a positive, there will be the magenta reddish color ring on the top of the tube, or we can say vial. Here in the methyl red, it will be the red in color, and vagus proscor here, if it is negative, no color change. And citrate, it is simmel citrate, it is green in color. And if it is negative, it will be showing no color change. But if it will be positive, it will be giving the, if it is a positive, it will be giving the bluish color. So here, as it is an E. coli reaction, so the citrate will be, yes. So as it is an E. coli, here it will be the greenish color. There will be no change. Here you have seen the positive, positive, negative, negative. Invic, I was saying. So here you can see the Invic pattern of the E. coli. So this is the particularly Invic color. Now, one more thing which I have shown you is the, after the Invic test, we can also produce, go for the TSI. Triple sugar iron agar. TSI is the triple sugar iron agar. Triple sugar, from the name itself, it means three sugars are being added into the media. And triple sugar iron agar means three sugars are in the media. And if iron is also, if there is H2S production will be there, there will be the color change. So here the important thing is, in most of the reactions, what we used to say in the previous, we have seen that the Invic pattern, we have made the butt or we have made the slant. But in case of TSI, the important thing is you have to make a large butt. This is known as the butt here, and the slant should also be there. So in this media, butt and the slant, both things are being required. So there will be the, if there is change in the color, you can see here. If it is an E. coli, it will be using the sugar lactose. And particularly if they have been using the sugar lactose, what will be there? There will be the acid production. If there will be the acid production, now reverse to the indicator which we have added in case of E. coli. Or the McConkie agar, what we have uses in the case of McConkie agar, the indicator which we have added in case of McConkie agar was the neutral red. But in case of TSI, what we will be adding, indicator phenol red. And this phenol red indicator is giving reverse reaction in comparison to the neutral red. Kehne ka matlab, neutral red jab hum use kar rahe the, वो एसिडिक में पिंक कलर शो कर रहा था और अल्कलाइन में येलो कर रहा था. अब हम क्या कर रहे हैं, यहाँ TSI वी आर यूजिंग, वी आर एडिंग द इंडिकेटर पर्टिकुलरली फिनॉल रेड. तो फिनॉल रेड क्या कर रहा है, अगर कहीं एसिडिक है मीडिया तो उसको येलोइश में कन्वर्ट कर रहा है, अगर कहीं ये अल्कलाइन है तो फिर क्या कर रहा है, वो उसको रेडिश चेंज कर रहा है, मतलब रिवर्स कर रहा है किससे, इन कंपैरिजन टू द न्यूट्रल रेड. यहाँ फिनॉल रेड इंडिकेटर है. सो इसमें हम 1% शुगर यूज करते हैं. तीन शुगर कौन सी हो गई, ग्लूकोज, लैक्टोज एंड सुक्रोज, तीन शुगर हो गई हैं. और हम जनरली ग्लूकोज 1% यूज करते हैं, लैक्टोज एंड सुक्रोज सब 1% पे यूज करेंगे और H2S इंडिकेटर. तो अगर इकोलाई का केस है तो इकोलाई क्या करता है, एसिड प्रोड्यूस करता है, लैक्टोज को यूज कर लेगा मीडिया का और लैक्टिक एसिड प्रोड्यूस करेगा. तो लैक्टिक एसिड प्रोड्यूस करेगा तो क्या होगा, एसिडिक हो गया मीडिया, एसिडिक हो गया मतलब pH इसका कम हो गया. तो यहाँ पे हमने फिनॉल रेड यूज किया है, इसके लिए क्या हो गया, मीडिया का कलर कैसा होगा, येलोइश कलर होगा. ओके, मीडिया का कलर कैसा होगा, येलोइश कलर होगा. बट अगर कहीं हमने दूसरा यूज किया, मतलब अगर कहीं वो लैक्टोज को यू फर्मेंट नहीं करा, अगर हमने साल्मोनेला ऑर्गेनिज्म को ले लिया तो क्या होगा, अब साल्मोनेला जो ऑर्गेनिज्म को हमने ले लिया तो वो लैक्टोज को छोड़ के सुक्रोज को भी छोड़ दिया मान लो, या सुक्रोज को यूज कर लिया और लिमिटेड ग्लूकोज है तो ग्लूकोज को यूज कर लिया, तो अब मीडिया में क्या बचा था, पेप्टोन बचा है. तो पेप्टोन जो बचा है, अगर जो पेप्टोन को यूटिलाइज करेगा एज ए नाइट्रोजन सोर्स तो क्या बनेगा, अल्कलाइन बनेगा. मीडिया में अल्कलिनिटी बढ़ जाएगी, तो अल्कलिनिटी बढ़ जाएगी तो मीडिया कैसा हो जाएगा, रेडिश इन कलर हो जाएगा, रेडिश इन कलर. ठीक है, और अगर कहीं इसके साथ ही साथ अगर मीडिया में H2S भी प्रोड्यूस हो रहा है, ठीक है, अगर H2S प्रोड्यूस हो रहा है तो क्या होगा, देयर विल बी द ब्लैकनिंग इन द मीडिया. तो जनरली अगर एसिड्स, देखो अगर यहाँ पे अल्कलाइन सॉल्ट और अल्कलाइन सॉल्ट और एसिडिक ब्लड में भी हमको कैसे मिलेगा, येलोइश कलर मिलेगा ही हमको. ठीक है, बट अलोंग विद दैट Here will, if it is the crackening also, इसको बोलते हैं हम crackening and bumping of the media. ये देखो bumping है, bumping मतलब कि media अपनी जगह से थोड़ा ऊपर उठ गया है. यहाँ crackening of media है, यहाँ H2S production है media पे, ये सिर्फ alkaline है, ये सिर्फ acidic production है. So these are all the interpretation in case of H2S production or TSI agar. तो पहली चीज क्या कह रही थी, direct examination. दूसरी चीज क्या करी, आइसोलेशन एंड आइडेंटिफिकेशन. जब हमने आइसोलेट किया ऑर्गेनिज्म को, फिर हमको उसको एक बार फिर माइक्रोस्कोप में देखना है, मॉर्फोलॉजी देखना है, देन वी हैव टू गो फॉर द आइडेंटिफिकेशन, और आइडेंटिफिकेशन में हमको बायोकेमिकल टेस्ट परफॉर्म करना है. नाउ अदर देन दिस, द सीरोलॉजिकल टेस्ट कैन ऑल्सो बी परफॉर्म इन केस ऑफ, कल मैंने बोला था कि सीरोटाइपिंग करते हैं किसकी, इकोलाई की. तो सीरोटाइपिंग के लिए क्या कर सकते हैं हम, सीरोलॉजिकल टेस्ट विच कैन बी परफॉर्म इज द स्लाइड एग्लूटिनेशन टेस्ट फॉर सीरोटाइप आइडेंटिफिकेशन. कौन सा सीरोटाइप है, हम क्या कर रहे हैं, स्लाइड एग्लूटिनेशन टेस्ट कर रहे हैं ओ और एच एंटीजन का. अदर जो टेस्ट हम कर सकते हैं, दैट इज द फ्लोरोसेंट एंटीबॉडी टेक्निक कैन ऑल्सो बी परफॉर्म on the fresh ileum of the fresh feces. Yeah, immunological methods hain, hum ELISA bhi perform kar sakte hain K88 aur K99 ke liye, ya fir hum ELISA FIMBRI ke liye nahi hai. Abhi maine bataya tha ki kuch jo E. coli hai, they used to produce the toxins, to hum toxins ka bhi determination kar sakte hain ELISA mein, and the heat stable and the heat labile toxin of the E. coli can be determined. और हीट स्टेबल में अगर 140 पिकोमोल होगा और हीट लेबाइल में 290 पिकोमोल होगा, देन ओनली देन इवन दे कैन बी डायग्नोस कि इतना इकोलाई टॉक्सिन प्रोड्यूस कर रहा है. एंड एंट्रोटॉक्सिजेनिक स्ट्रेन्स ऑफ द इकोलाई आर सस्पेक्टेड. or particularly it can be the antitoxins or the familial antigens can be confirmed. Or antitoxins or कैसे हम confirm कर सकते हैं by the use of employing monoclonal antibodies. अगर हमने ELISA polyclonal नहीं monoclonal antibodies के against किया तो और specific ELISA perform हो जाएगा antitoxins के लिए. Other than these, we can also go for the latex agglutination test. It can also be performed. Other than these, nucleic acid method. Nucleic acid method मतलब कि अब हमने वहाँ पे antibody antibody की बात नहीं कर रहे हैं. We know that if any of the organism is there, they are if any activity is there in any of the organism, they are all being governed by the gene. ठीक है? सभी activity किससे governed हो रही? Gene से governed हो रही. तो हमको क्या करना? PCR करना. PCR now everybody is knowing first year you are knowing about the PCR. So PCR technique we are using a specific all they are the oligonucleotides or the primers for the specific genes encoding the heat labile and the heat stable antitoxins. So the toxin produced by the Shigot oxygenate and the neutrotoxins can be detected by the Vero cell assay. ठीक है, पहले हम इसको क्या करते थे? Vero cell assay means cell lines we used to produce. But now we are detecting it by the PCR itself. अगर हमने primer design कर दिया है for the Shigot oxygenic and neurotoxigenic strains, we can amplify the toxins and we can see that the particular organism is having this primers or these genes or not. So the DNA probes is specific for the base sequence of E. coli genes encoding antitoxin and heat stable and the heat labile are also available. And the multi-locus variable nucleotide tandem repeats analysis methods can also be used for epidemiological analysis of intestinal disease caused by the E. coli. And the number of MLC schemes are also being available. So lots of techniques are being available for the detection of E. coli. MLSP is the multi-locus sequence typing. And there is the multi-locus sequence typing. MLSP of the E. coli is also available. Now, other than these, you know that whenever we have to say that this is organism, we used to go for the Cox postulate. अगर हमने Cox postulate को fulfill कर दिया है, तभी हम बोलते हैं कि this organism is being particularly responsible for causing the disease. So in most of the laboratory, अगर हमको Cox postulates को प्रूव करना है या लेबोरेटरी में हमने E. coli का कोई एक्सपेरिमेंट करा है हमको उसको प्रूव करना है तो वी कैन गो फॉर द एनिमल इनोकुलेशन आल्सो इन सकलिंग माइस. ओके, इन केस ऑफ सकलिंग माइस वी यूज टू इनोकुलेट द पर्टिकुलर E. coli इनटू द पॉ ऑफ पॉ जो रहता है पॉ एडिमा टेस्ट इन माइस. माइस का जो पॉ रहता का जो पंजा रहता है उसमें इनोकुलेट करते हैं किसको जो हमने आइसोलेट किया है और अलग फॉर्म हो जाता है देन वी यूज्ड टू से दैट इट इज ड्यू टू द ई कोलाई इंफेक्शन. तो पॉ इडिमा टेस्ट इज आल्सो परफॉर्म एनिमल इनोकुलेशन टेस्ट इन केस ऑफ ई कोलाई एंड इट इज आल्सो नोन एज द सकलिंग माइस एसिड. पॉ इडिमा टेस्ट अगर हमने पॉ मतलब जो पंजे में ई कोलाई को इनोकुलेट कर दिया है या सस्पेक्टेड सैंपल को इनोकुलेट किया है तो क्या होगा कि माइस के पॉ में इडिमा हो जाएगा. तो दोनों पॉ को हम कंपेयर करेंगे कि फर्स्ट डे हमने इनोकुलेट किया था एक पॉ में हमने ई कोलाई इनोकुलेट किया या सस्पेक्टेड सैंपल इनोकुलेट किया दूसरे में नॉर्मल इनोकुलेट किया. अगर फर्स्ट वाले में एडिमा हो जाता है जिसमें ई कोलाई या सस्पेक्टेड ई कोलाई सैंपल इनोकुलेट किया है देन वी विल बी सेइंग दैट दिस इज अ केस ऑफ ई कोलाई इंफेक्शन. सो पर्टिकुलरली आई वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट दैट कि हम यहाँ पे क्या परफॉर्म कर सकते हैं कौन सा टेस्ट परफॉर्म कर सकते हैं. दीज आर पर्टिकुलरली लेटेक्स प्लेट एग्लूटिनेशन टेस्ट, अगर हमने लेटेक्स प्लेट एग्लूटिनेशन टेस्ट किया है अगर किसी भी पिलाई के लिए, तो यहाँ K99 पिलाई फिल किया, तो ये देखो ये दिस इज द एग्लूटिनेशन, इन दिस केस इट मीन्स इट इज पॉजिटिव फॉर द K99, सो दिस इज द पॉजिटिव केस इन केस ऑफ इकोलाई, एंड दिस इज द नेगेटिव, हियर इट इज अगेन द पॉजिटिव, टेस्ट 3 रिएजेंट 2 3, दिस इज द पॉजिटिव केस. So here we, this is the result of the latex agglutination test. So which were the tests which we have performed? First we have gone for the clinical examination, then we have taken the history, we have to collect the sample, then direct examination, then isolation and identification of the organism, then coming for the immunological or the serological testing, nucleic acid method, and last it was the animal inoculation. In this way, if and the sample will be according to the disease condition. So I think now you will able to identify the diseases which are being caused by the E. coli in the laboratory. So the next about the proteus and the salmonella.